the purpose of my remarks tonight is just to sort of go over what I feel like are some of the basics around high stakes standardized testing. I feel like, you know, even now I work with, when I teach master's students at UW Bothell, I have a bunch of folks who are current K-12 teachers in my class. They take my class and I give them sort of some critical perspectives on policy, and they're like, man, we're having to do all this stuff, but we actually don't understand it, right? These are teachers in the classroom having to implement whatever, Common Core or anything else, any of the policies, and they don't really understand what the ins and outs are of the policies. So my comments tonight, my remarks tonight are going to sort of focus on just some of the basics around how we think about assessment and high stakes standardized testing, and then to take a few minutes to sort of point out and highlight some of the sort of critical issues around testing. If I may direct you to your blue printout, this is in lieu of slides, and I brought a stack up here in case there were some folks who didn't grab them. So, and this is just the quick and dirty sort of like look at high stakes standardized testing. And I always start my talks by being really clear that what I'm about to say, by no means, don't misconstrue this as saying that I or anyone else in this room, for that matter, that we're against assessment, right? Teachers do assessment all the time. They do it all day, every day with their students. And so, you know, we understand that assessment is critical for how we understand ourselves and improve our practices as educators, how we understand what our students are learning or aren't learning, and then how we can improve our practice to help them learn better, right? So don't take this as being against assessment. Sometimes I get that from people hear my critiques. A couple of technical things I'll point out here, like under this first part, basics of assessment. It's really one thing we need to understand that all assessments are really they're really just samples of a larger whole, right? A student, you give a student a test with some questions. You're not asking them about every single thing that you might have taught them that entire quarter or semester, right? You can only ask them a handful of things. That's one sample, and you can only do it in a small amount of time. Maybe you have a period or two that you're doing if you're doing sort of a typical paper and pencil test. So it's only a sample of time, right? And so it's really you're just pulling a sample of stuff, okay? Now the thing is that when we do samples for assessments, we work on this assumption that what the student does with that sample, we can actually draw some meaning from that. We can sort of extrapolate. We can say it correlates with a bit more general understanding that this kid understands algebra or this kid understands U.S. History 1, right? Just based on how they perform on that little sample. So what's critical about that then is to understand that any assessment that we do is actually it's indirect. Like we tend to think that we take the sample, the student does this here, and then we draw this, we say, oh, they got A or B, or they know this or that. We actually don't know what fills that gap, right? Because it's a sample, it is really an indirect measure. It's only, the technical term, it's only a correlation, right? We tend to believe it's causal, that you say, I teach you this, and you spit this out here, and I caused you to do that. We actually don't know that, right? We just have, you perform this here, I see what you, I taught you this here, you perform this here, and maybe or maybe not, they're directly related. Because you know, you might have read a book on U.S. history on your own over the weekend and done really well on the test and had nothing to do with me as a teacher, right? That's a possibility, okay? So our sample is always sort of imprecise that way. That's a critical point I'm going to come back to later. I liken it to a good example might be an opinion poll, right? You know how we have an opinion poll about whoever, about Obama or something, and they take what they call a representative sample, a random representative sample of 1,000 people, and these people, you know, 80% say this and 20% say this. And then we say, okay, everybody says this about Obama, right? And we take the sample of 1,000 people and try and generalize that, try and extrapolate a more general meaning. And really that's what's happening with testing, it's the same kind of thing. Also, it's worth pointing out, there's just different kinds of assessments, right? When we think about assessments, like now, when high-stakes standardized testing is a particular kind of assessment, right? But there's all kinds of assessments. So, example that we've often used in talks that we've done together is like, you know, my PhD, when I had to get my PhD, right, I had to produce a dissertation and I had to defend that in front of a committee of faculty, university faculty, right? So there's two samples there, my dissertation and then my oral defense. And then my committee looked at that and they said, okay, based on his performance, then he deserves, we can say he deserves this degree, this thing. Right, and that's a whole other kind of assessment than say a typical sort of standardized test to fill in the bubble, short answer, that kind of thing. Right, so there's different kinds of assessments, performance assessments, portfolio assessments. There's all kinds of assessments that we could be using. Okay, so what's a high-stakes standardized test? Nuts and bolts, all right? A standardized test is just a uniform, a standardized assessment that you administer in a uniform and standardized way, okay, under relatively uniform standardized conditions, right? Any assessment could actually be a standardized assessment. We could try and make a portfolio that we did in a standardized way in multiple classrooms. Now, the point of doing that standardization, the same test, given the same way under relatively same conditions, is so you can make some comparisons, right? And so you can say, okay, kid in this school over here in South Seattle did this well compared to kid over here in North Seattle did this well. And so we can make some comparison between them. Or this school compared to this school, and more increasingly, this teacher compared to this teacher, right? That's what the standardization does, is it sort of creates, it at least creates the illusion of this equal sort of playing field that you can make sort of comparisons off of, because it's everyone doing the same thing, so we should be able to make those comparisons. We also do that, just as a side note, I always make this point, you know, every fall is when the international test scores come out. In the education research community, we call it International PISA Day. It's like a day that we have, right? And if the PISA scores come out, and they always say, okay, US did this terribly compared to like Finland or China or Korea or somebody else. And I always have to make this point. When you hear that, okay, when you go out in the world and this comes out and you see it in the news or you hear someone bring it up for dinner table conversation, tell them it's BS. Okay. The reason is that it's an apples to oranges comparison, because in the United States we actually have we have a policy of educating everyone, versus like the kids taking the test for China's PISA scores are actually generally a privileged group of kids. And the poorest kids aren't in schools taking the tests; they're actually working someplace. Okay, so it's apples to oranges comparison. But that's just for debunking the big picture thing. High stakes. That's simple. Okay, so covered standardized testing. Now, a high stakes test. What makes it high stakes is when there's consequences attached, and we can think of all kinds of consequences, right? We have even just media scrutiny to have people in the neighborhood say, "Oh, that school got low scores. That's a bad school with bad teachers and bad kids." That is a form. That's a consequence. We're seeing it now with discussions about, for instance, can federal funding be withheld from schools who say they want to not give the Smarter Balance test? But there's also consequences for kids, right? The SAT is how well you do on a college entrance exam. That's a consequence. High school exit exams. There's consequences obviously attached to that. There's all kinds of consequences that can be attached to tests. But that's what makes it quote unquote high stakes. So, just flipping to page 2 in brief, this is like a quick hit on some of the like critical pieces, the critical critiques of high-stakes standardized testing. And also, I want to be clear about this. We could have a standardized test that wasn't high stakes. That could be a very different experience, right? That's kind of what they used to be. Back in the day, some of you in the room might remember like maybe taking an Iowa test, right? You just took it. You didn't know what for. You took it. And then they used that to like do some comparisons, but they never like penalized teachers or kids or schools for that. They just use it to almost take temperature and then kind of gauge that and then keep going, right? So if there's ways to use like a big standardized test in a non-high stakes way that could be potentially be very useful, but it's really the high stakes, and also now we're seeing the amount of standardized tests, the actual just boatload, the pile of tests that are on us that are really making this bad news. So one of the biggest problems with standardized tests, I talked about the sampling of like knowledge and skills and stuff before. They sample other stuff that we tend not to admit that they sample. Okay? So, for instance, English language fluency, right? Your level of fluency with English, as you read it on the page, is actually something that's being tested on any standardized test, or now on the computer, right? That's what it is now. Right? So you have a kid whose first language wasn't English at home, and maybe is an ELL, an English language learner, and is developing, then they're being tested not only on the content on the test, they're also being tested on their English language fluency. Right? And that actually should raise some questions about the validity of that assessment. Because here they are, instead of being able to work on the math or the reading or whatever, or the writing, they're like, first they have to work through what the question actually asked for and figure that out in a language that wasn't their native language. Okay? So one of the things you can tell us this is an issue is if we really wanted to test ELL's knowledge around, say, literacy and mathematics, we'd be testing them in their home languages. Right? Because then we can test their actual mathematics knowledge and not just their English language fluency. We're also sampling test logics. Tests are organized. They organize information in very, very particular ways, right? Whether it's like, take any multiple choice, right? Here's the question. You have to choose one like that. Like, Like, we don't operate like that in our real world, our lives. Like, knowledge isn't split up in those pieces, and we're not making that kind of choice. And so that's a particular kind of logic. And tests ask for particular kinds of logics all over the place. So we're actually sampling that, too. Someone's ability to understand the logics of a test and engage with it in a way so that they can decipher the right answer. In a high-stakes environment, we're also sampling a child's ability to cope with stress. Right? This test could mean, who knows, right? It could mean placement into whatever program, exit from high school, whatever. Or maybe they're just worried about their teacher, or maybe they're worried that it's going to make them look dumb if they don't do well. Right? So that's a stressful environment. And so what you're doing, when you're actually measuring a kid's ability to sort of process that stress and cope with that stress and get the answers right. So we're sampling an extra thing, and that additional thing on top of the content as well. Okay, so moving on down, just for the sake of time, there's other things we know that are happening with high-stakes standardized testing. Teachers in here know it already. Most folks in here should probably know it already. You know, we're seeing a loss of non-tested subjects, right? So if it's not on the test, it's not taught, right? And it's less so here in Seattle, but you see real extremes like Texas and California and some other places. But it is happening here. That's why there's a big fight about lunch and recess. We're seeing the diminishing of recess and lunch in preparation in favor of creating more space to prep for tests. Even if the research might say that actually if kids get to run around, they might do better on the tests, right? Also, we're seeing like a rise in bad pedagogy. Teachers end up being like having to like sprint to cover the content, and so they end up lecturing to get through stuff instead of doing more engaging, student-centered instruction, which could also lead to deeper learning. But we're losing that because of the testing. In terms of the consequences of testing, we're seeing all these bad effects, the narrowing of curriculum, narrowing of pedagogy, that kind of stuff, is happening mostly to kids of color and low-income kids of color in particular. And you think about that, makes sense, because in the framework of testing, failure gets concentrated around those kids. And so if those kids are the ones who are quote-unquote failing by that measure, then they're the ones who are going to, that's where the squeeze happens, right? Let's see. Also, the other thing that's happening is the consequences, and everyone's feeling it. You know, there's a culture of fear and distrust that sort of undergirds the testing, right? It presumes that you as a teacher are not competent, that you as a parent or might be a bad parent, not teaching your kids, not working with your kids at home. It presumes all these things and gets used as like, almost like a bludgeon, right? To beat you up. And so think about it as what does that do to a school environment, right? Is it about the learning, right? Or is it working out of fear of punishment? Another good piece of research, a terrible, terrible like finding, but in terms of like thinking this through, there was a study in 2013 that found that exit exams, while didn't have any long-term impact on employment, but they actually increased the kids' chance of being incarcerated by 12.5%. Right? Because if you fail the exam, what happens? You get out of school, and then you end up getting on a path to getting locked up. So you see this link to the schools to prison pipeline actually directly through high-stakes testing. I think it's sort of taken for granted that when you have a standardized assessment, it has a hard time taking account of the diversity of learners taking that test, right? Because standardization by its nature, doesn't allow for that much diversity. The other big piece in all this is that non-school factors, lack of medical care, food insecurity, housing insecurity, these major issues that we associate with poverty, are actually overwhelming factors in determining kids' test scores. Okay, David Berliner, who's a credible researcher, we've known this for decades, by the way. You can take 60 to 70% of any test score and attribute that to out-of-school stuff. And really, for all this talk about using tests to evaluate teachers, but even the statisticians will say, well, a teacher accounts for maybe like 17% of a test score. Okay. But you wouldn't know that if you talk to the politicians down in Olympia and around the country in general right now. There's the other thing to know is it's just massive error rates for using tests for these high stakes evaluations of teachers. Okay, various studies, but they keep coming up in these studies. What they end up finding is that you have someone who like scores really well one year. They're like, oh, you're the top 25% of teachers this year based on your student test scores, and then the next year they're like the bottom third. And you go, wait a minute, what happened? Either you decided to like teach really poorly your second year, or the kids changed, and the conditions of the kids changed, and that's really it. It ends up being a measure of who's in your class, and not so much your teaching. All that's to say that really value-added models, what you're seeing like with the current House bill around tying tying the test to teachers' evaluations. That whole value-added model, seeing how much, I mean, even think about the language. How much value is a teacher adding to a kid's test score? That's what the language says, right? That's just, it's a junk science. It's like, it's statisticians and mathematicians having fun with equations and not really understanding teaching and learning. So please just understand that. The last couple things I wanted to point out is if you look back 100 years, we basically have the same inequalities around high-stakes standardized testing. Go back to the original IQ testing in the United States that really is connected tightly with the eugenics movement, and go back to the early 1900s. These Stanford psychologists were testing people all over the place when they were like quote unquote objective measurements, and lo and behold, they're finding that by their measurements back then, well, poor people have lower test scores than rich people, and native-born have higher test scores than immigrants. And even Northern European immigrants had higher test scores than the swarthier, darker, more Mediterranean European immigrants, right? And of course, black people and native folks had lower test scores, so they must be less intelligent, right? And so I always have to raise this when I look at anytime we talk about achievement gaps now, I'm like, dude, don't you guys see we have the same, it doesn't matter what test you're giving, it's 100 years later, we basically have the same achievement gaps. And so the question to always ask is, are they measuring what everyone says that they're measuring, right? And I think the research would say it isn't. That it's measuring maybe access to resources. It's also measuring your parents' education. It's measuring a whole bunch of other stuff. But all that is basically a measure of social and economic inequality, and not of actual teaching and learning. We've had No Child Left Behind actually was law 13 years ago, right? Last month, basically. It's been 13 years of federally mandated high-stakes standardized testing. We've seen no improvement on anything, right? There has been no, for all the talk of like these business folks talking about these models of improvement, I'm like, how long do you need failure in your business before you decide to ditch something, right? And we've had this going on for over 12 years, and we're not seeing closing of any of these test score gaps. Teachers are feeling it. The profession is being killed by this. Teachers are losing their autonomy. They're feeling like they're not treated like professionals. And we're seeing that news stories about how hard it is to keep people in the profession, how many young teachers are just leaving, that kind of stuff. And then the mega corporations like Pearson, they just don't have any accountability. Pearson sort of runs education these days, them and the Gates Foundation and a few others. And you can't, like, when Pearson screws up, it's not like we can hold them, we can't vote Pearson out of office. And even that process is long, and voting people out of office is a crazy, messy process. But with Pearson, what do? Right? They have the contract with the state, with the district, with whoever. And a piece that I think is really important for everyone to know is that, just as a final thing, and this is Pearson's doing this here locally. If you've checked Craigslist ads in regions around the country, including the Seattle area, they've been advertising, do you have a college degree? Come help us score tests. Right? So Pearson basically sets up these test scoring facilities with people in cubicles, sometimes with people working at home. It's often considered, it's like, And you go through this training, but it's considered like, it's almost like piece rate assessment. So you have a kid's essay, and basically you have a kid's essay. Maybe they've worked on this for a long time, whatever. They prep, they take the essay. At Pearson, you're considered slow if you spend more than 30 to 60 seconds per essay. Right? And this is a kid's future. And it could be a teacher's job. Right? And so really, when you take assessment and put it into this sort of factory model, you start to lose the humanity behind it, and you can see that happening in all sorts of ways. So that was my 15 minutes. That's all I got. I worked with the sweat process.
Well, thanks, everybody. It's clear that this was needed because we had to add chairs to the back. This is wonderful. I'm Jesse Hagopian, and I teach at Garfield High School, and people probably here have heard about the MAP test boycott that happened 2 years ago when the entire faculty voted to refuse to administer a test that they couldn't give in good conscience. And several of my colleagues are here tonight who helped to organize that boycott. And that really helped. That really helped to ignite a movement around the country. And I've been working on fighting against these tests and helping to implement an alternative to them in a serious way ever since. But this year I got a new look on what these tests could mean and the harm that they could do because my son entered kindergarten, right? And so we hear in Seattle administer the MAP test to kindergarten, well, not to my kindergartner, but kindergartners are supposed to take it very soon. And so the year started off incredible. They just renamed my son's school, and it became an international school with a bilingual program. So they did this huge ribbon-cutting ceremony to start the year off. And it was an amazing event. The kids all came out on the front lawn, and they had students in the Chinese dragon costumes doing an incredible performance. They had all these different cultural performances to celebrate the new bilingual program. They brought in all these politicians. The school board members came and spoke. The principal gave a wonderful speech. And then the governor's education aide took the podium. And she's addressing all of these kindergarten through fifth graders sitting out on the lawn. And the first thing she says, "Congratulations to you all for deciding to come to this school this year, because you will now be ready to compete in the global economy." Right? Yay! Cheers did not erupt from the third grade section. I wasn't like, yes, my son will be able to keep down that other child in Mexico. That's why I want him to learn Spanish. Right? Don't we want them to learn another language so that they can communicate and collaborate with more people, not this global this global struggle. And in the research for my book, More Than a Score, there's a couple of quotes that I want to read to you, because I think it frames why they're pushing these high stakes tests on our school. Bill Gates, actually Wayne insisted I include this quote, which I'm glad he did. He said in 2009 of why we need the Common Core and the tests that come shrink-wrapped with it, he said, quote, "When the tests are aligned to the common standards, the curriculum will line up as well, and that will unleash powerful market forces in the service of better teaching. For the first time, there will be a large base of customers eager to buy products that can help every kid learn and every teacher get better." Now go to the Common Core website and check out this prominent quote from Edward B. Rust Jr., chairman and CEO of the State Farm Insurance Companies, who tells us why we need the Common Core. He says, quote, "State-by-state adoption of these standards is an important step towards maintaining our country's competitive edge. With a skilled and prepared workforce, the business community will be better prepared to face the challenges of the international marketplace." So the reason my kid is in kindergarten is to get ready to help a business compete globally, not so that he can help out somebody who's had a bad day, or learn how to be a good friend. Or at his goals that he told me for the year was learn how to tie a shoe, play basketball, and learn another language, right? But those are irrelevant to the world's wealthiest people who are using their wealth to radically transform the purpose of public education. And what they've done is just inundate our schools with these tests. It's incredible. One parent in Chicago, when I was speaking there, told me that her kindergartner took 14 standardized tests in the year. There's teachers here. Andy at Dearborn should talk about the number of tests that the kids take there, and other teachers or parents, if you know the tests that are taken here in this city. The AFT did a study to look at how many hours are spent on testing across the country. They found in a mid-sized city, they did three or four cities, they compared, is an average of 50 hours with up to 110 hours a year in direct test prep activities for them, right? So when we talk about the loss of lunch and recess, right, that's what we're talking about. Here in this city, we know it disproportionately, the loss of lunch and recess falls on the South End schools, right? Because we know that they've declared that the reason why we need these tests is to close the achievement gap, as if a thermometer cured a fever, right, and a broken thermometer at that. But they say that we need these to close, so we're going to just inundate the schools in the South End with high-stakes testing. And what we found KUOW did a story last year that showed there were 20 schools in the South End that had less than 20 minutes of recess a day. We found this year, how many schools have, the average was like 13 minutes for lunch now?
We just did a study and they did 8 schools and it averaged to 13 minutes. It ranged from 7 minutes of lunchtime to 6 minutes.
The kids are getting 13 minutes now to eat their lunch on average. And we know it's disproportionately impacting the kids in the South End, so they're not getting to finish their lunch, throwing away huge amounts of food, and oftentimes trying to rush out and get one of the last few minutes of recess they can get, going against all research on the benefits of play and nutrition to learning, right? And they're using these tests in really, really detrimental ways, as Wayne said. Just a couple examples, right? In Chicago, they just closed 50 schools, right? Where? In the black and brown neighborhoods. In 2008, we closed 5 schools here in Seattle that they're now scrambling to try to figure out how to reopen because there's not enough space, right? But they use these tests to label schools failure and close them down because they would like to actually open up charter schools that then are privately run, right, with taxpayer funding, but privately run. They use these schools to deny kids graduation, and as Wayne said, that is fueling the school-to-prison pipeline. They use these tests to try to undermine the teachers' unions, to try to destabilize the teaching profession, and there's really no data that shows it's improving teaching at all. And we've had it, as Wayne said, for the last 12 years. So we should have heard back now. Yes, this is helping us get better teachers, and we've seen these results over the last 12 years that are showing No Child Left Behind is working and making progress. And in fact, no research has shown that at all. So here at Garfield, we decided to unanimously refuse to administer the MAP test. The superintendent threatened the teachers, especially those in math and reading who were in the directed tested subjects. He threatened with a 10-day suspension without pay. But the teachers knew this was wrong and knew that the superintendent stood on the wrong side of history and knew that these tests were abusing our children, and refused to back down, and it spread to other schools. Some teachers in this room teach at those schools. Orca, Chief South, were two of the schools in the South End that took up this fight. Also, you know, we had Thornton Creek join the fight, and Center School, and it became a major battle that people all over the country flooded us with letters of solidarity. And what happened was they turned from just giving us support, the thousands of emails and letters saying this fight is a fight for all of us, to actually taking up their own struggles. So a week after Garfield announced our boycott, students in Portland walked out. Students in Chicago walked out against these tests. Students in Rhode Island did something we should consider. They actually organized an event where they said, okay, if these tests are the key to decide who's career and college ready, then let's get the professionals and have them take the test and see how they do. Okay? So the Providence Student Union packed a room of doctors, lawyers, politicians, and professionals to come take the exam. And a week later, they held a press conference to release the results. 60% of these professionals failed the test, right? And it was unequivocal proof that these tests really have nothing to do with being ready to enter society. That what they're being used for is just a test and punish model. And what the Common Core folks have told us in the Smarter Balance Consortium, they have released the cut scores here in Washington State, and they have told us that 60 to 70% of your children will fail the test this year, right? And they say that actually that's a great victory for public education because finally we're having high standards, right? Right. The key to public education is to demoralize everybody with a test that actually, right, doesn't really predict much about your ability to perform well in your job or in life beyond. I don't buy it. And I'm willing to organize a fight against that. And a lot of parents and students and teachers around the country are too. I just want to read a quick excerpt from a teacher in Chicago from the book, and from a couple teachers in Chicago to give us some ideas. And then I want to just say a quick word about the alternative to these tests. And then there's so many people in here with expertise that know all the policy around how to opt out, what impact it might have, and we should all share that wealth of knowledge in this room in a moment. But I want to read from Sarah Chambers, who organized an action at her school Sesedo Elementary School in Chicago. And she said, "It was testing day. I had just read the directions which instructed my students to fill in the bubble of the letter that corresponds to the best answer choice. The students had dutifully began reading passages and darkly shading bubbles with their number two pencils. All the students had begun except for one of my 11-year-old boys at the end of the row of desks who had stalled and he was slouched over his test booklet. I watched as he plucked his eyelids out, his eyelashes out one by one, agonizing over the standardized test that would determine, in part, my efficiency as a teacher and contribute to the overall rating of our school. In that moment, I thought to myself, this over-testing is child abuse. I cannot inflict this mental and emotional harm on one more student. That's when the word boycott first flashed across my mind. This is the story of how an emotion became a movement." And she goes on to describe the fact that they didn't just threaten with a suspension without pay, they threatened these teachers with the revoking of their teaching certificate if they refused to administer this test, which our superintendent has just taken a page out of that book, saying that that could be a punishment for teachers here in Seattle now, right? So it's a clear indication when a superintendent has to make the ultimate threat of revoking teaching certificates that he actually has not convinced anybody of his position. That it's not very sound, that people don't really agree with it if you have to resort to the threats. And in Chicago, they were so convinced that the ISAT, the test that they boycotted, was harmful to the students, that even that threat did not keep these teachers away from their boycott. They saw it through to the end. And just like at Garfield High School, no teacher was actually reprimanded because everyone did it together and they couldn't fire everybody, right? Teachers in Chicago as well staged a plan, something I think we should think about doing, where they went down to the Department of Education, rolled out their mats and their rugs and got toys and guitars and bubbles and started showing what was being lost in public education, right? The power of play to help in early childhood education, and actually made a huge impact in the media showing the very important skills that are gained through play that are lost when it's pushed out in high-stakes testing. So I just want to wrap up by saying that Garfield, ever since the MAP test boycott, has been partnering with a school system in New York City. And a couple teachers here, Heather was here, probably with her new baby in the back, and Rachel and I and a couple other Garfield teachers and our principal have been flying to New York over the past 2 years. I think they've made 4 or 5 trips. And we're partnering with this New York Consortium Schools for Performance Assessment. The New York Consortium Schools started with one school in the mid-80s. They've now grown to a network of around 30 different schools, 6th grade through 12th grade. And they have a waiver, so they don't have to give the state tests. They're fully public schools, they're not charters, but they're allowed this one waiver where they don't have to give the tests. And instead, they do performance assessments. Now, if high-stakes standardized testing was the key to closing the achievement gap, creating a wonderful opportunity for our kids to flourish and to have a nurturing and rich education that increased graduation, then these schools would be at the very bottom of New York, right? They should be by No Child Left Behind standards, by Race to the Top standards, by Common Core state standards. These schools should be at the very bottom because they've never given one of these tests. There's only one problem. They're at the very, very top, right? And here's the thing. They have higher numbers of special needs students than the general population of the New York public schools because they take the kids that are kicked out of charter schools. Charter schools often want to push out kids who lower their test scores, right? So they can show, oh, we're producing these wonderful test scores. Oftentimes those kids get ushered out as discipline problems, kicked out to the general population. The New York Consortium schools welcome them in. And they say, we have a different model and a different purpose for education. And here, what the kids do is basically what Wayne described. They do the PhD process from 6th grade through 12th grade. It's developmentally appropriate, but they develop a thesis in every subject, right? They do research over time. If the research doesn't match the thesis, they change the thesis, right? They work with their teacher. Then at the end of the grading period, they will go and present that information and that material. And they actually bring in people from the community to look at this work, right? So much like you have the panel of experts for a PhD, if you're in a language arts class, they'll bring in an author from New York City or a journalist, right? And then when your assessment, instead of being time away from learning, where you have to get pulled out of class to go waste time on something that probably is only very loosely connected to anything you've done in the classroom, instead, the assessment is actually this amazing time that the teachers and students there have described to me as wonderful breakthrough. Because now, can you imagine your art class? You've spent all semester working on this wonderful piece of art, and now a New York artist comes, and you get feedback from this professional on your art. And they push you to think about it in a new way, right? Or, you know, in your language arts class, you get feedback from that author, and they push you to think about your writing in new ways. And it can be times of great breakthrough. And that's why the New York Consortium schools have the highest graduation rates. Their kids attend college at much higher rates than the rest of the New York public schools. Their stats show that they stay in college longer because the critical thinking skills that are developed. We abandoned the high stakes tests every month in the K-12, and then you get to college and they want you to think, right? But they just start the thinking right away. Imagine that in 6th grade. And so they're staying in college longer and they've actually have incredible success with graduating more students of color. And I think that's a model that we would do well to bring to Seattle and to talk about how can we have assessments and inquiry-based education that actually push critical thinking, that push collaboration, that ask our kids to imagine and value creativity. And I think just to end by saying that You know that the corporate education reformers and the testocracy doesn't really believe in their own product, and they know that what they're pushing is not the best for all of our kids, because for a couple of reasons how you can tell this. Number one, they would be flying out the principals of these consortium schools all over the country to talk about why they have such amazing results, right? But you won't hear about them unless you're at a grassroots forum like this where parents, students, and teachers are spreading the word. And the other way you know that they don't really believe in this regime is because look at the schools that they send their kids to. Where did Bill Gates go to high school? Right? Lakeside. Where does he send his kids to? Lakeside. I've often said that actually Garfield did not start the MAP test boycott. Lakeside started the MAP test boycott. They never administered that test, right? They wouldn't pull their kids out month after month, inundating them with these standardized tests, because they want their kids' time for creativity. They want the arts to flourish in that school. They want these wonderful, enriching experiences and small class sizes and time to interact one-on-one. At the same time, the wealthy elite are do nothing to help McCleary get funded so that actually all of our schools can be equitable, or 1351 that was just passed by voters to lower class size and looks like the legislature won't even honor it. So I think what's good enough for their kids at the elite schools is good enough for our kids here in the South End, and I hope that we can join in that fight together to win a better school system for our kids. Thank you. This is Doug. He is on the executive board of our union, SCA, and teaches at Nathan Hale High School.
I wrote down a lot of things to say. Nathan Hale is kind of in the center of this right now. I want to describe for you our process. It went differently from Garfield's boycott. We learned a great deal from Garfield's boycott, and the sentiments of it were true, and the insights were true, and the actions were beautiful and inspiring. We thought that because we were kind of a nerdy school, we would go about it in a what we call a Nathan Hale way, which is we would do it as a result of a process that would be that was our sort of decision-making process. So we began to study the issue of high-stakes standardized tests. We invited Dr. Au to come speak to us. He gave you essentially the same speech that he gave you. It wasn't a well-attended meeting, but the next one was a much better-attended meeting. And in the process, Nathan Hale went about their nerdy process, which is our nerdy process, which is we took it to our faculty senate. And our senate consists of teachers and students from every class. It consists of parents. It consists of staff and administration. And after considering all the factors and doing due diligence, we decided that the staff, or the Senate — I'm not a member of the Senate, I don't speak for them, I'm describing their process. I helped write the resolution, though. So they decided that the 11th grade SBAC test would not be given at Nathan Hale this year for very specific reasons related to the 11th grade test. The 11th grade test is not necessary for your students to graduate from high school. There are three ways they can get out of high school. One is by taking the SBAC. Two is by taking a collection of evidence at the end of the year. And the third is by passing the HISPE tests. So no junior at this point needs to take this. If you're following that, then you know that probably 400 juniors at Roosevelt High School will be taking this test and don't need it. And they'll be spending 8.5 hours in testing and away from their classrooms and away from AP test preparation, which they need very intensely. Another 400 will probably be at Garfield, who don't need to take the test. Another 400 at Ballard. Teachers have been told in a variety of ways, in a variety of contexts, that advising parents to opt their kids out is a no-no. So I advise you to opt your kids out. But the particularly if they're juniors. We decided that it was a bad test for our juniors because, long story short, it was a waste of their time. It was time better spent in class. It was something that the testing company was going to use for its own purposes, its own commercial purposes, to help calibrate it, rather than for the help of our students. So the 11th grade teachers got together, I'm one of them, and decided that we would not do it. But the sad part of all this, and what we're facing now, is that the Seattle School District can force and bully its teachers and principals into offering this test. It is very possible that at Nathan Hale, this test will be given. Victory here would mean that parents decided to opt their kids out. So when I get contacted by the press, which is pretty rarely, but they say, are you going to back down? And what they don't understand is that this question needs to be taken by the parents and taken by the students as their responsibility. And I understand completely why that hasn't happened, because parents trust us to make decisions about what's good for their kids. But we got a note from our, I got it right here, it's awesome. We got a note from our superintendent that says, I'll just paraphrase. Not only will we be guilty of misconduct if we do what I just did, which is to say that I won't give the test, but if we don't give proper notice, he will go after our license to teach in the state of Washington. A couple of math teachers at our school decided they took personal offense to that. They'd never been treated that way by anybody in their profession, and they wrote emails that have become controversial at our school since then. And we're waiting for the other shoe to drop on that. But I won't give the test. Furthermore, I want to point out that even though Hale will not give the 11th grade test, or if we do, it'll be administrators giving it to as few students as we can manage. And I hope that's true of all your schools. But that the 10th grade test will go on. And the 10th grade test is an ELA test. And this is the mainstream funneling of students into the SBAC system. What it means is that all of the 10th graders in Washington State will take this thing called an ELA test, English Language Arts Test. It is required for their graduation, unlike the 11th grade test. We've gotten a lot of publicity for the 11th grade refusal. And that's good, because it brings questions up about the whole testing regime. But everything that's wrong with the 11th grade test is wrong with the 10th grade test. And it's a requirement for their graduation. If they don't do well on it, I mean, if they do well on it, this is the carrot. If the kids do well on this 10th grade test, they don't have to take it in the 11th grade. They'll be declared college and career ready. And I suppose, just like Jesse said, they'll be ready to make sure that that Chinese and Mexican and African kids all over the world continue to live miserable lives. The other part is that this test being required, if they don't get that sort of imprimatur of success, they have to take the same thing again, the full battery in 11th grade. And then they need that to graduate. So a couple of consequences if that happens. The superintendent in this letter said, hey, don't get all worried. It's only 8.5 hours of testing in the library. There's so much wrong with that. There's so much that really worries me about our superintendent's basic connection with reality. And that is this. Picture an environment where 60 to 70% of the 10th graders fail this test at the end of this year. You think that 8.5 hours isn't going to blossom into 8.5 more hours and more hours in preparation? The newspaper stories, the public shaming of teachers and students and schools? All of a sudden, once this test gets into the groove, once it gets into the system, the test will be the school board of this city. The test will be the superintendent of the city. And this test is invalid, it is unreliable, it is inequitable, it is racist, it's going to have racial outcomes that are disastrous for our students. It is the opposite of what our students need. Just one little statement from Dr. Howe's book, which is called, not more than a score, but that's a great book too. And they're both great books. It's called Pencils Down. An article in there describes how a test question gets to be a part of a test. Test questions are tested themselves and sort of, they are test driven. This is Rifkin's article.
Oh, for the SAT, you mean?
Yeah, for high stakes standardized tests. To be specific, this is the SAT. How do you get a new test question into the SAT? Well, it has to conform to the same pattern of right and wrong answers that other test questions have. That's how it gets validity. Validity, I suppose, I think means, go ahead, correct me.
Well, validity is just that it's measuring what you say, but it's measuring.
Oh, that's okay. So reliability means it's consistent from year to year.
Yes. Yeah.
Okay. Validity means it's testing what it says it's testing. So in order to become reliable and therefore easy to sell to states, new test questions must mirror the results of previous test questions. And if you have a history of underperformance, that is to say, what's called the achievement gap, the so-called achievement gap, if black students don't do as well on a question, that's okay. But if black students do better on a question than white students, that is not an acceptable question. That question will not get incorporated into the new SAT.
Because
it does not conform with past performance. And past performance is what determines the reliability of a test.
It's like the infinity mirror.
It is a mirror looking at itself into infinity. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
Who grades the test?
Well, that's a wonderful question. I want you to come to my school.
We have time for a variety of responses too, so it's fabulous.
The short answer to that is some machines and it's a part-time.
Oh, I'm almost done.
Robots.
So.
We also do. I mean, would we want to hear this? And we want to make sure there's time.
Okay.
Because there are people from lots of schools with stories to share.
That's okay. Thank you very much. Anyway, there's going to be more trouble at Nathan here, and we need your support.
So I just wanted—I don't know if I'm the only one in the room. If I am, then skip this question and move on to somebody else. But I have acronym paralysis, and we want to opt out, and we're trying to figure out which things we can opt out of at different levels. And I mean, it seems like SBAC and MAP across the board can be opted out of. But if there's some nuance, and I mean, is anybody else confused by the acronyms and they keep changing the names? Yeah. Or am I the only one and we can skip
the
question?
So the ones that we know are MAP, the Measures of Academic Progress, and that's done from kindergarten, people who know this, just kindergarten and first right now,
kindergarten,
right?
Kindergarten, first and second. And then some schools still do it for the rest of the elementary grades, and some schools do another test called Amplify. There's 40 schools that are piloting Amplify, and both of those tests are what they call growth measures. So they're offered 2 to 3 times a year to measure whether. Andy, please speak.
Okay, on Amplify, I'm an elementary teacher here in Southfield, and Amplify is hysterical because I think they knew that SBAC wasn't going to be ready. I mean, like, we still don't actually have the materials and the preparation we need to administer the test. But they gave us Amplify, and I'm a pilot school, and it's supposed to be beginning, middle, and end of the year to show growth over time. But they didn't start right away, so we took the beginning of the year one in, like, late October. And then, literally 3 weeks later, they said, okay, you got to give the middle of the year one. And I said, well, and the thing is, the beginning one, all it showed is that my students haven't learned the things I haven't taught them yet. So, and then they give us the middle of the year one in November. And then it comes to late January or February, and they're like, well, we got to give you the end of the year one. It's like, this isn't the end of the year. And they said, yeah, but that's SBAC, so you'll take that then. So they took a year's worth of testing for Amplify, compressed it into about 3.5 months. And it's just ridiculous. And I know some of my colleagues dutifully look at all the data to see what it shows, and it just shows, oh, the things I haven't covered, they don't know. And I honestly barely look at it beyond the minimum requirement. So Amplify would be a great one if you have a 3rd through 5th grader to opt your child out of, because it is utterly useless. But that's just my 2 cents.
So MAP, Amplify, SBAC, those are the three.
Those are the major ones, but there's a whole bunch of other ones that other teachers can talk about that have crept into the schools. And you can write a letter and list them all out and say, I don't want my kid to take any of these tests.
It's also a form.
Yeah, yes. And do we have forms here tonight? Or?
Yeah, we have. There's opt-out forms up here, just a sample with some information on it. But in Washington State, all you have to do is write your principal a note. You can email, you can handwrite, you can do whatever. Like, in Washington State, it is parents' right to opt out of any standardized test for any reason. People may tell you otherwise, but you can cite the law, and that is the law.
Is there language? I heard there's language you have to use. Is there specific language you have to use? No.
There really shouldn't be. The district now has an opt-out form on their website, and so I can see that some schools may think that they need to use that one. That's
made it sound kind of scary. They make you check boxes that make you feel like you're doing something detrimental to your child. Or the school, right. But it doesn't have to be that long.
Are there effects on the teachers or on the school?
So it depends on which test and what grade level. I'll say what I know and then people should fill in the gaps. The first thing we should understand is that every one of you attends a failing school. In fact, every single kid in the entire state attends a failing school, right? Because No Child Left Behind mandated that all schools in the entire country reach 100% proficiency in math and reading by 2014. Almost every single school in the entire nation is a failing school by that measure, but most of the states received waivers, so they didn't have to get that label, right? There's just a couple states that didn't receive the waiver from Arne Duncan.
Got it revoked.
Got it revoked, right. Got our waiver revoked. Because we didn't tie teacher evaluations to test scores in a percentage way, they revoked our waiver. So now every school is failing. So that what that means is when they threaten you with, well, it could, if you opt your kids out, it could lead to the school being labeled failing, right? Well, for us, we're in a state where that is really irrelevant. That's the first, I think the first thing to understand this. The second thing they say is if, No Child Left Behind says 95% have to take it, or they can, 95% of the kids in the school have to take the test, or they can revoke federal funds. The thing is, in New York State, they had around 67,000 opt-outs. We're currently in the largest period of resistance to high-stakes tests in U.S. history. Right, it's a mass movement across the country. 67,000 parents in New York State, which meant that around a quarter of all the schools had more than 5% of the parents opting out, and not a single school lost any money because when it's that large, right, they can't, going and punishing all the schools just drives more people to opt out and say this whole system is rotten. So these are a lot of usually empty threats.
I teach at Franklin, and last year we were a school of distinction because our test scores went way up, and we lost money because the school district decided, well, you're no longer a failing school, so we don't need all the support that was the thing that caused us to be doing better. So they took away $400,000. So now it's like I'm opting my son out who goes to Franklin. And I'm thinking, oh, good, I'm doing my school a favor because now we go back down.
And we should be clear, though, there are specific grants, for instance, ties to specific test scores for specific schools. And so, sometimes undermining the tests can undermine the functioning of that grant. So I want to be really clear that there can be immediate consequences when they're tied. Because so often these grants just get tied, like the only way you can show it's working, the grant is working, is if test scores go up. Right, and that's the logic at least, and so I would be, that's one piece of this I would be sort of cautious about.
There's
not at this point, not individual teachers, not yet, but
if all the parents opt out, then it's a moot point. I mean, the tipping point or critical mass. If enough parents opt out, then teachers don't have to risk their jobs, and they stop attaching grants and other things to the.
In general, yeah.
I'll just say there's a story in here of Castlebridge Elementary in New York where 90% of the families opted their kids out and they had to cancel the test because there weren't enough kids to take it. And they got to go back and learn.
So there's a ton of hands going on. Like, you've had your hand up for a while, the yellow sweater. Sorry, I don't know.
So first of all, I guess I could introduce myself by saying my son also started kindergarten at Grenville. I'm also an eight-year veteran teacher from California, where every year I signed an affidavit saying I would not look at the test or talk about it, and every year I opened it up to look at the question. Yeah. So I have serious concerns when my students were being asked what the margins should be, an inch or one quarter inch in my ELA classes. I was teaching honors students, I was teaching the literacy students, and I was teaching ELL students in the Bay Area and in the Central Valley of California. So I am no deep friend of standardized tests, but I have some concerns about the opt-out movement that I'm hoping you can answer. The first one is that there seems to be a conflation of testing and high stakes. And the first thing that, in the research I'm doing right now with project-based learning in urban underperforming schools, is that the NAEP, the National Assessment for Educational Progress tests, have been going on since 1970. We look at those as the nation's report card to indicate areas that are weak in teacher preparation and school performance and student performance. Those have never been tied to teacher salary or anything along those lines that would be considered high stakes. That test is extremely useful because it's a national sample. The part of the problem with No Child Left Behind the last 13 years when we've seen no change in testing is partly because every state was left to design its own assessments. So there was no comparison, and states with mixed up or poor substandard standards had low performances. Whereas states like Connecticut, Washington with the WASL actually had pretty decent assessments and showed pretty good performance in the areas where students were performing well. So there's an explanation for why for the last 13 to 30, since No Child Left Behind, standardized assessments haven't showed us any shrinking of the achievement gap. But tests like NAEP still show us that there's really big disparities. And I'm concerned that the move for the Common Core and the national, the Next Generation Science Standards actually emphasize deeper learning, more inquiry-based, instead of too hard to tell the difference between answers or the margins, you're asked to select the text and use more evidence-based reasoning. They're not perfect by any stretch. I don't think that the Common Core standards are perfect at all. There's many flaws in how they were created and how they're being rolled out connected to the assessments, but they are an improvement over a lot of the really irregular standards that were out before. And I'm concerned with the opt-out movement that we are conflating assessment in a good, positive way for national awareness of disparity and equity issues that is being covered up. Like, I want to fight against tying it to teachers. I don't want assessments to be tied to teacher. I want to be tied to teacher preparation and awareness and more support, but it should not be a value-added measure. I want to fight against that more particularly than I want in the MAP test, which they can't explain what it tests or why we should give it. Those kind of tests are ridiculous, and we should have a way to speak out against those. But I'm not convinced I want to say that my son shouldn't be part of showing whether the Common Core standards can actually have a broader measure of more critical, deeper thinking across our national landscape. And I'm a little confused right now, especially having come from a Bay Area school with a really nice socioeconomic diversity, where the first principal that when I landed had an amazing portfolio assessment. We had terrible California state tests, but they weren't high stakes. And we had the performance assessment that was really thought very highly of. And then the principal changed. And guess what happened with those performance assessments? It became the lowest bar possible. The teachers were all given a sheaf of 20, told you have a couple hours to get through them. There was a lot of rubber stamping going on, and what used to be a really good assessment turned to be really rubber stamping. So I'm hoping you can answer for me to clarify, how do we distinguish some of the issues? Because I don't want to opt out of potentially a better standard and approach.
So, but there's so, like, you just brought up so much stuff, and for real, like, you need to, I mean, absolutely, like, if you take Texas, or Arizona, or Nebraska, like, I mean, there are really regressive standards in some of those states, like, racist and just ridiculous, like, I feel you on that. But, so there's a couple questions that come to mind. One, let's see, I'm trying to think the best way to start. One is to say, we have no evidence that just raising standards actually improves education. Well, but you also just named several states that had decent standards relative, and they still had those problems with the achievement gaps, even across the times of high stakes standardized testing. And so the question then becomes, is that where we start? Is that the key lever for improving education or closing achievement gaps?
I know we should go before, but it's like, look at Boston. Really good teacher pay, really good teacher preparation, lots of residency programs, lots of really
and
good it's, teacher
it's
support.
It's still huge
and
race and economic inequality.
But they do
yes.
a better job across some of those gaps.
Still
than
huge,
other
still huge gaps. The other piece I'll say is this. Historically, the only reason we've had standards is to attach a test to them.
Yes.
In the history of high-stakes standardized testing and the history of standards developed in this country, even the quote-unquote good standards movement of the 90s was always had the end game of tests being attached to them, high-stakes tests being attached to them. So I don't think it's even realistic to argue, oh, the tests are the high-stakes part of the tests are this separate thing from the standards, because the standards are only here because they want to test them. You see what I'm saying? Like they exist as part of the same hand-in-hand. And like, you know, I'm not opposed to higher standards. I'm not opposed, and I have serious critiques of the Common Core and what they're exactly asking. I don't think the development appropriate for younger grades. I think a lot of early, like, and I think there's problems with the math stuff. I mean, there are real issues with the Common Core too. But because for me, because the issue, like, we pretend that education exists apart from, like, if we just raise standards or increase teacher pay or have this policy in education, it's going to fix all this stuff. And we do need to have all this stuff to fix education. But actually, honestly, educational policy is social policy. Like, until we have, like, livable wages, universal health care, like, all these things that these quote-unquote high-performing countries have, like, we're just playing around in the dark, and we're just messing around with stuff. So I also think the Common Core standards and testing, like, discussion ends up being political spectacles, political theater, to avoid having to deal with these other issues that are really serious. You know what I'm saying? So I don't know, but there's a whole bunch more we could talk about that stuff. But I question whether they are better standards, and I also question whether the assessments are actually better assessments. Because if you talk to the test makers, they say we actually don't have the technology to do this yet, right? And there's a ton of stuff.
Can I just say we have less than 10 minutes left, and we'd really like to hear from as many people as possible. And you're welcome to stay after and talk about this complicated stuff.
Yeah, there's a ton of stuff.
I don't know who's got their hands up.
Yeah, and how about in back? Hello, everyone. I'll stand in the back. Good to see everyone. My name is Norma, and I'm a fourth and fifth grade teacher here down in South Park. And it's my first year of teaching, and I'm so inspired by the children. I'm actually inspired by everyone who can see as well, and I thank you all for coming. To our presenters as well. What I wanted to say is, as a fourth and fifth grade teacher, and as a parent as well of a child in first grade, there is a lot of fear. Some of the things, I work in a pretty high and impoverished school. There's a lot of wealth there in terms of cultural wealth, in terms of social wealth, there's a lot of depth of knowledge there, but there isn't economic wealth, which positions kids to, well, it positions kids in already a pretty unequal playing field. And because of that, there's also a much more punitive environment. Principals are terrified. Teachers are terrified. Garfield and Ethan Hale, I love you guys so much, but you actually have a lot of wealth in your schools in terms of economic wealth that our schools do not have and our parents do not mobilize. Our Latino parents do not mobilize. I'm a Latina parent. I mobilize. My parents didn't. They did not have the education to mobilize. They did not have the language to mobilize. In our school, it's a bilingual school, it's a dual language school. But our parents are fearful, and they're terrified. And my question is, and I completely agree with you, I believe that the Common Core is something, as a first year teacher, entering into this arena after 15 years being away from a teacher, it does professionalize our own profession in some ways, but I also am completely understanding. I think that teachers need to be held. Teachers have been there for a really, really long time. Sometimes they get a little lazy. At the same time, I also know that there's a lot of wisdom there. I've seen the good and the bad of it all. There's nothing to be said about, I mean, that's how complex education is, right? That's how complex our social landscape is. So I get what you're saying, but I am so driven as a parent and as an educator as well to really think about really opting out. As a teacher, I can't do, as my first year teacher, I have a provisional contract, so I can get fired tomorrow because of anything that happens. I don't get any kind of contract until the next 3 years, so I have to sort of do everything on the download. And I want to do so many things, but I'm holding my breath, and I'm just wondering, what can we do for parents who are fearful, for teachers who are fearful, for my colleagues who are terrified? And I have some colleagues here, some parents, colleagues and parents also from my school. What do we do with the fear?
I mean, those are great questions. We're running short on time, so why don't we take one more question and or a couple questions, and then we'll answer a few things together. Can we? Is that fair? Okay. All right. Let's do that just to make sure we hear a couple people. So we have right here.
I don't have a question. I had a strategy for some of the teachers. If that's okay. The sign you see up here in the wall. I teach in Olympia at the Pioneer Elementary School. After researching the Washington State Disclosure Commission guidelines stating that I could indeed have bumper stickers or window signs on my car in the school parking lot and suffer no repercussions, I created that. That hangs on the back of my car every day at the entrance or the exit of my school parking lot. Okay? Every day. And so this week we're in parent conference. That's on the front row. Every person who walks in the building can see that. Every parent for the whole week. I wear a button because I can wear a button that says opt out of standardized testing. No one can tell me to take that off my car, nor can they tell me to take this off myself. And what I did, what I do with parents, no one. The ACLU is chomping at the bit to have this case.
So she can be fired without cause.
No, she can't.
Yes, she can.
That is no.
Yes, she can.
You don't have to say why they fire a provisional.
So we've been told by the union here. We've been told by the union that we have the right to wear a political button, whether it's what candidate you're for, or a ballot initiative, or anything that you believe in. Is teachers have the right to free speech to wearing political buttons. So that's what the unions told us. Of course, everything can be contested, right?
That's what the state says, too.
Right, but.
So the other part of that, I'll finish up with that. The other part of that is, at parent conferences, I've been sliding the count, you know, informing parents when their children are in these test sessions. Almost unanimously, parents go, oh my God, that many? And they say, how long is that going to last? I said, well, a rough estimate would be minimum of 2 hours on all six of these days. But we could go 5 hours on this. Well, that starts the question. That starts the conversation. What can you know? That's ridiculous. I can't have my kids doing that kind of thing. And then I have a webpage that I have placed 6 links. 3 of which go to opt-out sites, 3 of which go to state sites. And then we have
to wrap up.
Yeah, we're going to have to end on time out of respect for our child care folks, but many of us will hang around. I'm a parent at Dearborn Park, and we've done some work around this. Mr. Russ is also a teacher. Rachel, who's one of the organizers, is a parent at Hawthorne. So I hope that after we end this formal part, we can also just informally talk about strategies for different schools and different situations.
Can I say one thing to address a couple of the questions that we didn't get to?
Okay.
I'll make it quick. I just want to say, one, around the Common Core, the part that you glossed over, I think, is the part that we really need to focus on. Like, there are some problems with it, but let's look at there were no early childhood educators involved in the creation of the Common Core standards. And what that means is they're wildly developmentally inappropriate for the early grades. There's a lot of other issues with them. So as Wayne said, sometimes even that is a lot better than what some states have, as you said. There are states with terrible standards. Our state wasn't one of those. So these came in, and a lot of the standards look similar, but then there's these huge gaps that are a big problem, right? And the last thing to say is that any of these tests that are A, B, C, D, bubble choice tests, which Common Core is primarily still, even though it brings in a couple of other things, it's primarily an A, B, C, D bubble test. They train our children to believe that wisdom is the ability to eliminate a wrong answer choice, not to think critically, right? And so these assessments like the NAEP, I think, can give us broad checks, and I think that they have a role. But let's not pretend that this is a quality assessment that tells us how the child arrived at answer choice C, right, or that developed critical thinking. And let's go for a much deeper form of assessment that that I think can empower all of our kids.
One thing that I'd like to say, looking at the Common Core standards and everything that's happened, is that I don't know if parents understand that Common Core standards are only for the English language arts and math. So that means that there's an emphasis on only two subjects in terms of the testing, in terms of the preparation. That eliminates history, civics, science, any other art, drama, any other subject that you feel is important for your child to have as in terms of a well-rounded education. Gone. Because of the Common Core standards as they stand now.
So before we do a couple of last, like, where we go next, you had your hand up for a long time, too. Did you have a question you wanted to ask?
If you're in elementary school, middle school, and high school, can you, refuse to do the test even if you were opted out of it?
Well, that's a good question. And actually, not if, yeah, can a child opt them refuse to take the test?
No, they need a parent to sign.
Yes, they can.
They cannot do it on their own.
So,
they cannot opt themselves out. They cannot write their own opt out letter if they're under 18.
And I think you have to have a talk with your family at the high school where they, you know, some students did refuse to go. Some whole classes refused to go take a test. And that does make kind of a problem for the teachers when the whole class won't go. I think if, you know, an individual takes a bigger risk by themselves, then so you have to figure out with your family how to work out. Because the teachers will want to go back to the parents. So thank you so much to everyone for being here tonight.